Dear students, in this module, we will covering Thomas Doubleday's Dyad theory, the three groups of society according to Doubleday, criticisms of Thomas Doubleday's Dyad theory, Jos D. Crasto's protein consumption theory. We will discuss and comprehend two theory of population, one by Thomas Doubleday and the other by Jos D. Crasto. According to Doubleday, there is a relationship between population growth and diet of people. He thinks that poverty stimulates population growth since the diet of the poor is insufficient. According to D. Crasto, the deficiency of protein makes undernourished people more fertile than those who are well nourished. Thomas Doubleday's diet theory. Thomas Doubleday, 1790 to 1870, was an English social philosopher and economist who wrote about the natural laws governing population. In his book, The True Law of Population, Doubleday tried to establish a relationship between population growth and the diet of people. According to him, poverty stimulates population growth since the diet of the poor is insufficient. Doubleday based his views on a common observation among animals. Rabbits and swans, he said, it will not conceive if fed to a certain high of fatness. He maintained that while the Chinese, Irish, Scots were highly fertile because their diet was inadequate, the birth rates in France were low because the French were well fed. Doubleday proposed that the rate of population growth would be less when the quantity of food supply is more. This means that the increase in population and food supply are inversely related. Doubleday also mentions two states influenced by food supply. That is, one, low fertility in a condition of excess food supply, and two, low fertility in a state with food shortages and poor nourishment. According to Doubleday, fertility is affected by leanness in plants and animals. An overfed plant can be revived only when the plants are depleted, either by wringing their bark or by extreme lopping of branches or the trenching of the roots. Besides, sterility in plant life is possible when fertilizer's use is excessive. Doubleday also observed that higher fertility can be observed among vegetarians or those who eat more rice or whose staple diet is rich, having more nutritional value. Non-vegetarians tend to be less fertile. The three groups of society according to Doubleday, the first group includes those who are in a state of affluence and are well supplied with luxuries. Their numbers are in a state of constant decrease, while the number of those engaged in mental or physical activities and living a busy life is on the increase. Number two, the second group consists of the poor people who have less supply of food. The number is increasing rapidly. In other words, the constant increase in population is found in the group whose people are worst supplied with food. This happens in all societies. The third group consists of those people who form the mean of two opposites, 1 and 2. They may be considered as the average income group. People in this group are tolerably well supplied with adequate food and nutrition. They do not overwork and yet are not idle. Their number is static. Doubleday was also of the view that, according to him, the rich produce less children as the fertility would be less amongst them, and therefore the transfer of their wealth will be distributed among a few people. Over a period, it may happen that there will be no one as heir to that property, and therefore this wealth will pass to the children of the poor. There are criticisms of Thomas Doubleday's diet theory. Doubleday's theory was criticized on several grounds. His observations about an inverse relationship between food supply and fertility has no rational basis. According to Doubleday, fertility is low in the plethoric state due to adequate supply of food and is high in depletoric state due to food shortages and diminution of proper nourishment. However, such events have not been experienced in society. In fact, the population rises even in the plethoric state. Doubleday believed that rich people have less children, whereas the poor have more. This is far from being true, because in many cases we find more children in rich families and less in the poor ones. Doubleday opined that the number of those persons who get a normal diet and in the average income group remains stationary. However, experiences have shown that even in such income groups, the number has always been increasing. Doubleday is also of the view that fertility depends on fatness, which is the result of the excess foods consumed by the rich. Spencer has criticized this presumption of Doubleday because every rich person may not be always fat. Spencer, in fact, felt that fatness does not fully depend on decent food. The root cause of fatness is bad digestion. It's true that today the rich are more conscious about their health and their families. They make every effort to keep themselves and their families in good health with visits to fitness facilities, medical treatments, etc. Doubleday felt that socialism will be established by automatic distribution of wealth by nature. This argument does not have any scientific basis. In Doubleday's diet theory, there is a confusion between fertility and fecundity. While criticizing the theory of Doubleday, Thompson and Lewis have said that there is no scientific basis for the belief that the proportion of protein in the diet or the relative abundance of intake of calorie has any noticeable effect upon fecundity. Jos D. Crow's protein consumption theory. In 1952, Jos D. Crow, his period being 1908 to 1973, in his book Geography of Hunger, contended that the deficiency of protein makes undernourished people more fertile than those who are well nourished. He based his conclusions on the negative correlation between the protein content of the diet and the birth rate of various countries. De Castro's views on the correlation between fertility and the consumption of protein were based on his acceptance of the findings of R.J. Solankar, who had conducted experiments on rats in 1920 and found that with the increase in protein consumption in diet, fecundity had decreased, and thus it was expected that a low protein diet would increase fecundity. Solankar's observations and conclusions can be drawn here. 1. When 10% protein was given to a female rat, each mated female rat gave 23.3 births. Number 2. When 18% protein was given to each female rat, each mated female rat gave 17.4 births. Number 3. When the quantity of protein was increased to a level of 22% to each female rat, the birth per mated female rat reduced to 13.8 births. Castro concluded that fatness is affected by consumption of protein. Fatness increases with protein in the diet, leading to lower fertility. Castro's propositions are like Doubleday's diet theory, which states that the rate of population increase is influenced by food supply. Castro also found a direct relation between the functioning of the liver and that of the ovaries. In his words, it is known that there is a direct connection between the functioning of the liver and the ovaries, the role of the liver being to inactivate the excess estrogens which the ovaries throw into the bloodstream. Fatty degeneration of the liver and the tendency to cirrhosis, that is a condition in which the liver does not function properly due to long-term damage, are some of the characteristic result of protein deficiency when degeneration of the liver occurs. It begins to operate less efficiently and is less effective at its job of inactivating excess estrogens. The result is a marked increase in the woman's reproductive capacity. According to Castro, balanced food is not available to the poor, and therefore, poor people are always getting less protein in food, which results in sluggish liver function. Consequently, when males have defective livers, the estrogens in woman's body cannot be neutralized, and with an increase in estrogens, woman's reproductive capacity increases. This results in a high birth rate. According to Castro, people or societies are blamed for the high birth rate in poor countries, which is not correct. For this, the rich countries or people of affluent societies should be blamed because the imperial or colonial powers did not take steps to improve the standard of living of their people, nor did they make the attempts to provide healthy food. On the contrary, instead of concentrating more on the increase of food production, imperial powers have concentrated on the purchase of raw materials and food supplies at low rates, and finished products have been sold out at high rates in their colonies. As a result, due to unaffordable prices and low wages, people cannot access a balanced diet, due to which they cannot get enough protein. With reduction of protein or its complete absence in the diet, the capacity to produce more children increases, which eventually results in even more poverty. Thus, a vicious circle sets in. Castro found it painful that adequate attention was not being given to the problems of an unbalanced diet by the rich, capitalists, and scientists. He felt that importance was being given only to commercial interests and less to the social aspects of poverty. Castro reflected on the issue with reference to India, where of the total number of children born, almost 50% suffer from starvation and die before they reach the age of marriage. Based on data related to the association of fertility with consumption of protein for different countries, Castro concluded that in 1952, 2/3 of the world's population experienced chronic hunger, that is, malnutrition, disease, or early death. In the words of Castro, when deserts of ice and impenetrable jungles are being turned to gardens and orchards, when the lands we farm and the plants we grow are being made to multiply their field, and while we are barely learning how to tap the great food reservoirs of water, the wild flora and of artificial synthesis, the Malthusians go on setting up their sinister scarecrows. Castro concluded that effort should be made to bring more land under the plow with improved farming methods and extensive cultivation. This would be only possible through economic development, leading to rising incomes for the poor, which would increase their protein consumption. There are certain criticisms of Joseph D. Castro's protein consumption theory. They are: high fertility has been observed in many developed countries with increased protein in the diet of the people. Number 2, there is no scientific basis for the assertion that a protein-rich diet leads to lower fertility. Number 3, fertility always does not increase in poor people, because it is not true that chronic hunger will always give more importance to sex. In poor countries, the reasons for high birth rate are poverty and unbalanced diet. However, the influence on population growth of factors like agriculture based economy, social, religious or cultural structure of the society, education, existence of joint family system, marriage at early ages, etc., cannot be ignored. Economists do not accept the view that human fertility depends on diet alone. According to Kunj, fluctuations in fertility during the trade cycle cannot be explained in terms of diet. Castro's view that with the economic development, fertility can decline has been criticized by Lebenstein. According to him, the reasons why this approach is fallacious is that the economy might not have experienced sustained development if fertility rates had not declined at some crucial stage during the expansion. The relation between diet and fecundity was criticized by Thompson and Lewis, who said that there is no scientific basis for the belief that good diet or relative abundance of calorie intake have any noticeable effect upon fecundity. Rather, fertility may be affected by the preventive checks of various kinds, while fecundity remains unchanged. Both the theories, Doubleday's and Castro's, have been accepted by demographers who maintain that fertility variations are associated with business cycles, which are obviously not associated with diet. Many courtiers in the West experienced an upsurge in fertility once economic recovery set in, especially during 1937-38, following the Great Depression of early 1930. This phenomena cannot, of course, be attributed to low protein consumption, even if it is granted that reproductive capacity is determined by diet. The utilization of the available food depends on many other social, psychological, and economic factors. In this context, Thomilson's sarcastic remarks on Castro's theory are very pertinent. He says, I quote, "He might as well have considered that correlation between national fertility and consumption of soda, use of washing machine, or watching of television." These are some of the points that comes out that in this theory, we are able to see that the nutritive component, how it is important in influencing the fertility, is very well reflected in these two theories, so that there is always a important conclusion that we can make that it is very important that a diet plays an important role in influencing the fertility behavior, and in that context, food supply and fertility, how they are related to each other and how the nutritive diets play an important role in influencing the fertility behavior as brought out by in these theories are well documented. In conclusion, in these theories, one important thing which we notice is that these are the theories which have laid down emphasis on bringing the relationship between the diets, the food supply, and the other side of fertility and fecundity. Though there are different views that are expressed by these scholars, we need to notice that this is a new dimension in which the food supply or the diet, how important it is in influencing the fecundity and fertility aspects, are clearly explained. To that extent, these studies played an important role in contributing to the understanding of various theories that are there in the area of fertility. The important thing is, given the society in which the food intake, the various aspects of various components in food supply, and also the diet effects are well brought out, and to certain extent it was also made to emphasize that the effects of the food supply or the diet, how they are influencing by showing some of the experiments through animals and plants and then extending for the human behaviors are very well reflected in these theories. Both the theories, Doubleday and Castro's, have explained that the variations in fertility, how they can be influenced because of dietary factors, are well explained. And furthermore, the situation in which the period of these societies were moving are very well reflected when these scholars have interpreted the relationship that exists between the diet or food supply and the calorie intakes of the food that the nutrition played the role in the among the people who are living at that time. So, this is another important dimension. Though there are certain limitations in interacting with the relationships that exist between fertility or the fecundity with the influence that comes out due to dietary habits, but there is a vivid way of presentation that how the dietary intake plays an important role in influencing fertility is a new dimension that existed, and the relationship is always debatable and also discussed thoroughly and brought out in various forms. To that extent, we need to see that these theories we have to very clearly understood in understanding the relationship that exists between food supply and the dietary and its relation with fertility and fecundity of the human aspects that are there to mainly to contribute for the population growth of the particular society in which they were living, and also the contributions makes a worldwide phenomena where the rich and poor, when they are having a different dietary habits, and when they are, whether they are poor or rich, how their dietary habits have influenced their the fertility behavior is well noticed, and that is why these theories are to be understood in that context.